Order for point then.
You are in order.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, in anticipation of Governor Branstad's budget message, I think it's important for us to review today the budget environment as it currently stands. The state and national economies are still struggling. We have passed the lowest point of the Great Recession and begun to come back, but we still have a long way to go. Unemployment remains unacceptably high. Too many Iowans are out of work and too many families are still feeling the pain. We are all committed to helping them get back on their feet. That being said, however, it must be at the same time recognized that Iowa's economy is much stronger than those of most other states. Our unemployment rate, for example, is about 30% lower than the national average. So it is with our state budget. For the last 8 or 9 months, state revenues have been coming in above forecast. Last September, we closed the books on fiscal year 2010 with a $335 million surplus. In October, the Revenue Estimating Conference raised its forecast of state revenues, both for the current fiscal year and the next. In December, the REC raised its estimates again, and at the end of December, actual revenues were coming in ahead of even these increased estimates. We are on track to run a surplus of about $500 million this fiscal year. We will end the fiscal year with our reserve funds full to their legal limit, and barring some major screw-up, our AAA bond rating intact. Few states can match our outstanding record of fiscal responsibility, and most would envy our position. This circumstance did not happen by accident. Long-term vision by Governors Vilsack and Culver, with significant bipartisan support, created the Values Fund and the Power Fund to promote job growth and investment in cutting-edge technologies for the future. Tough fiscal decisions and sacrifices were made to balance this year's budget without a tax increase. Again, with bipartisan support, we enacted reorganization and early retirement measures that will together save about $300 million in the current fiscal year. We not only complied with the requirement to limit spending to 99% of estimated revenue, we came in even lower than that by $92 million. Make no mistake, we face significant challenges in next year's budget, but we come at them from a position of strength. We will have to replace Federal Recovery Act dollars in a number of areas, starting with $600 million for Medicaid. We will also need $231 million to fulfill our share of the K-12 funding formula. The good news is that we have the money to do that and to continue level funding for other existing programs, including preschool and the community colleges, and we can do that without raising taxes. The bad news is that we don't have much money to do a lot else. Based on the most recent estimates from the Legislative Service Agency, our budget gap for next year currently stands at $263 million, not an unusual figure at the start of the budget process. This is doable. Major new initiatives or tax expenditures, however, will be very difficult without violating our obligations to core services in education, corrections, transportation, and other areas. Smaller efforts targeted at job growth or providing some additional allowable growth for K-12 may be possible, but will have to be done prudently. I am not suggesting that we ought to do a level-funded budget in all areas, just that we can. What I am suggesting is that because we can do that, while meeting our obligations without a tax increase, a level-funded budget ought to be the benchmark against which we measure alternatives. For example, is it worth cutting off middle-class kids from preschool in order to fund giant tax cuts for wealthy corporations? These are the kinds of questions we will have to address in the coming weeks. We must be ever mindful of the need to manage the public's money well and to provide quality services at a reasonable cost. This is especially true in difficult economic times, but because we have prudently managed in the past, cutting expenditures, producing balanced budgets, and protecting our state's credit rating, the challenges in front of us are manageable without draconian measures. We are not California. We are not Illinois. We are Iowa.